organizational justice, and corporate spirituality. These paths are compatible with the core concept of humanistic management, which your institution espouses, namely unconditional respect for dignity of life, practice of ethics in all business decisions, and working with stakeholders to promote corporate social responsibility activities. Let me say a few words about what prompted me to write this book.
Professor Khandwalla, if you can sit little behind, we will be able to see your full face.
Okay.
Little more.
Little more, all right.
Yes.
Yeah. This is better?
Better, yeah.
Thank you. Consider the extent of business misconduct that has come to light in the last few decades. A number of corporations have been found to engage in wrongdoings such as bribing government officials, producing shoddy or even fake products, false and misleading advertising, driving out competitors through unethical means, conspiracies to fix prices, exploitation of employees, especially gender-based and community-based discrimination, using strong-arm methods to make customers pay, window dressing accounts to show higher profits and thereby jack up stock prices, insider trading, and wrongfully influencing government policies. Corporate crime has reached alarming levels all over the world. In the US, for instance, the world's most advanced market economy, according to studies in the 1990s, two-thirds of Fortune 500 companies were convicted of serious crimes ranging from price fixing to illegal dumping of hazardous waste. In India too, we have had our share of corporate crime. Satyam Computers, Malia, Nirav Modi, the Bellary mining scam of the Verities, and most recently, Yes Bank readily come to mind. Such business misconduct raises questions about the viability of our market economy. How do we retain the strengths of the market economy and reduce its potential misconduct? Yes, liberalization, deregulation, globalization have enabled the Indian economy to go from 4% growth rate until the end of the 1970s to around 6% growth rate since. But the country continues to be ranked as one of the world's most corrupt societies by Transparency International. How do we retain the strength of the market economy without stringent regulation that may breed widespread corruption and impose huge compliance costs on both the corporate sector and the regulatory apparatus? How can we make the market economy more humane so that the economic development yields is rapid, decent, and inclusive? These questions led me to write to a wide search. I looked for examples of companies that were high performers on the business front and also were ethical and or displayed high corporate social responsibility. I also looked for research findings on the relationship between decency and profitability. This relationship is crucial because in a hyper-competitive business context, if decency leads to serious erosion of profitability, few businessmen would take the route of decency. I have reported in the book the cases of around 100 companies all over the world, big and relatively small, in a wide range of manufacturing and service industries, and in developed as well as in emerging market economies, that were profitable and also trading one or the other paths of humaneness I was investigating. Let me share briefly the efforts of a few of these companies. Sony Corporation of Japan is well known for its innovations that have revolutionized how we entertain ourselves: magnetic tape recorder, transistor radio, Walkman, color TV, camcorder, and so on. Not many know, however, that Sony had a strong social concern. It explicitly set out in 1945 to assist in the reconstruction of Japan after its devastation in the Second World War, and to change the reputation of Japan from being a producer of cheap, shoddy products to one of a producer of innovative, high-quality products. Tokyo Electric Power Company, the world's largest power utility, with a power generating capacity of nearly half of India's, had in the mid-1990s achieved sulfur and nitrogen oxide emission rates of 0.4 grams per kilowatt hour, compared to 6.5 grams and 3.2 grams in the US and Western Europe. Several small and medium-sized companies have also been trying to be decent and profitable. Day Chocolate of Britain, a votary of fair trade movement, fights for a fair deal for third world producers. For instance, cocoa growers in Nigeria, cocoa being a key ingredient of chocolates, have been an exploited lot. So Day Chocolate put two cocoa growers on its board to make their voice heard. Day Chocolate in its hiring gives weight to those prospective employees that are aware of, believe in the fair trade movement, and have participated in community development work in third world countries. Several profitable Indian companies have also demonstrated a strong corporate social responsibility. For instance, Gujarat Ambuja Cement have provided help to some 30,000 farming and horticultural units and set up three hospitals by 2001 through its foundation. Hindalco and Aditya Birla Group Company has impacted some 1,120,000 persons in over 100 villages by assisting in watershed development, education, capacity building, literacy, health, and so forth. National Mineral Development Corporation, a public sector company owned by the Government of India, has also been very active in community development. It has provided free medical care to some 50,000 people in tribal areas, built over 30 bridges and culverts, given medical equipment to local hospitals, trained rural youth for self-employment, and built nearly 200 kilometers of local roads. Tata Steel has, of course, an outstanding record of corporate social responsibility. It has beneficially impacted the lives of several hundred thousands of tribals living around its plants. It has also reduced its energy and other inputs per ton of steel produced by around 15% during the past few years. A key question is, does commercial prosperity lead to humane management, or does corporate altruism have a beneficial impact on business performance? I look for research evidence for finding an answer to this question. Research indicates that corporate goodness pays. Many studies in the West have tried to find out whether corporate social responsibility is linked to business performance. In the majority of the studies, a positive link was found. In an American study of 650 companies, increased CSR was associated with subsequent improvement in business performance, thus suggesting a causal link from CSR to business performance. Other studies have shown that, at least in the West, both prospective job seekers and prospective customers prefer a strong CSR company to one with a bad record, and increasingly, mutual funds use a CSR and ethics screen to screen out investments in much less humane companies. Such investments may have crossed the $2 trillion mark by now. Such a screen can buoy the market valuations of decent companies. A further interesting finding is that CSR increases the price-earnings ratio of the company. So if you put all the research findings together, humane companies are likely to have more loyal customers and employees, better profitability, and higher price earnings ratios. Goodness pays handsomely even in India. Just look at the market valuations of strong CSR companies like Infosys, Wipro, Lupin, Tata Steel, and several Aditya Birla Group companies, all attempting to work profitably, but also decently, and do their bit for society. Even corporate spirituality may have positive social and top and bottom line consequences. it has been demonstrated time and again that when TM or transcendental meditation is done together by a group, crime and violence rates tend to fall. In several cities around the world, this Maharishi Mahesh Yogi effect led to reduction in serious crime by almost 20%. Even corporations may benefit from synchronized TM. In one American chemicals and auto parts company, TM was tried out by a group of managers and other staff at the same time and place for 4 years. Productivity rose by 54% during this period, sales per employee by 88%, and absenteeism declined by 89%. I was charmed to read the abstract of a paper of Ashish Pandey, Rajan Gupta, and AP Arora, which empirically found in their Indian study that spiritual climate has a positive association with learning in teams, and team learning mediates the relationship between spiritual climate and team level innovative behaviors. Humane management particularly pays off when it is allied with competent innovation. A concept called innovation premium has emerged. This is the premium equity investors are willing to pay beyond the valuation merited by present income for expected future profitable growth through innovation. Several Indian companies with a strong CSR record and also a strong successful innovation record command high innovation premiums. These include the likes of Hindustan Unilever, Tata Consultancy Services, and Sun Pharma. The model that emerges from my research is the following. Corporate commitment to humane management in a relatively corrupt business society leads to a wide search for profitable but decent alternatives to current inputs, processes, outputs, and activities. What has been taken for granted so far gets actively questioned. This search can yield profitable innovation ideas that can strengthen both top and bottom lines. If these ideas are executed competently, profitability rises and the corporation's commitment to humane conduct increases because such conduct is experienced to be in its self-interest. If such conduct becomes widespread in business, it can help create a humane business civilization that promotes strong, decent, and innovation-powered economic growth. Innovation and competent implementation of innovations can add much value to humane management. In recent years, I have got increasingly concerned with the drift of our human civilization. The negatives at times seem to overwhelm the positives. How can we enhance the excellence of our civilization? I drew, of course, on my corporate management insights, but ranged much beyond it as well. I want to share some ideas on how to enhance civilizational excellence, especially in the context of modern India. These ideas have been elaborated in my recent book, Fast Forward Toward Civilizational Greatness, Agenda for India, now available on both Amazon and Flipkart. In the modern context, to me, a civilization excels not because it is a super economic or political power, but above all, if it is largely a humane, creative, and competence-seeking society. Humane civilization evokes in me the imagery for people that are just, honest, and tolerant. They care for the weak and the needy. They're polite, civic-minded, law-abiding, generous, and caring even for foreigners. A humane civilization nurtures and upholds the best virtues of humankind. As Gandhiji said, the greatness of humanity is not being human, but in being humane. By a creative civilization, I mean a civilization which promotes offbeat, innovative and constructive means for meeting human needs and problems. It encourages creativity in the arts, sciences, professions, enterprises, livelihoods, and even ideologies. By competence-oriented civilization, I mean one that has a norm of doing tasks well beyond the call of duty. The norm impels people to continuous learning and improvement and great satisfaction at doing a job really well. The widespread pursuit of creativity and innovation, as well as of competence and humaneness, is powerfully synergistic. Widespread creativity and innovation provide a stream of novel offerings. Widespread humaneness tilts these toward benign uses. Widespread competence ensures high quality implementation. The result is a rising spiral of excellence in civilization. We urgently need to think of designing a much better civilization. Market competition, when it's based largely on greed for money, and a democratic system, when it is largely based on greed for power, often degenerate into widespread corruption and violence. The beast in man comes to the fore. Sophisticated though it may be in attire and communication, ethics often go for a toss. Look at human brutality and the canker of corruption and crime all over the world. As the poet William Butler Yeats put it, over a century back, things fall apart, the center cannot hold. Mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. The blood-dimmed tide is loosed, and everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. The best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity. My quest has been, can we design a civilization that uses the creativity and enterprise and efficiency of the market system and the freedom to be and act of the democratic system to nourish the best in humankind rather than to dehumanize it? Later on, I want to share some thoughts on how this may be done in the Indian context. But first, let me cite the example of Sweden, where this has been achieved to a fair extent. Consider these facts about Sweden. Sweden is an affluent country of 10 million with a per capita income of, in PPP, that is purchasing power parity, terms of $47,000 or so, only about 10% less than that of the United States. Sweden is a democracy in a market economy with sizable public and private sectors. It was not always so well off. At the end of the 19th century, there was widespread poverty and Swedes were migrating out of Sweden in significant numbers. In industrial development, it was way behind Britain, France, and Germany. Its economy grew rapidly in the 20th century to surpass that of Britain and France. Sweden is what she is today because of the choices she has made in the 20th century. For much of the past 100 years, Sweden has chosen a liberal and egalitarian democratic socialism within the framework of a competitive market economy. It is marked by a deliberate effort to foster cooperation between owners and workers and an elaborate economic safety net. There has been a partnership between capital and labor, with government oversight to resolve disputes between the two factions. The government forms policy in consultation with the employees' federations as well as the labor federations. A labor court made up of 3 impartial members and 5 representing employers, workers, and salaried employees has jurisdiction over the application, interpretation, and enforcement of collective agreements. Industrial peace has generally prevailed since the end of the 1930s. Swedish law requires employee participation on boards of directors of companies. The government has created an all-encompassing social welfare system for the citizens, paid for from a progressive taxation regime. Earlier than the 20th century, the Swedish government evolved a compassionate welfare state. It has become a model for many other nations. It provides financial security to all citizens. There's monetary support for citizens up to 16, and support is also available for older students. Benefits are provided to both parents to be able to be home from work to take care of the children for up to 480 days per child. Special benefits are provided to care for sick and disabled children. Housing allowance is provided to them, to those who can't afford housing. There are benefits if one is ill or disabled and can't work. For the unemployed, also for up to 60 weeks for those who are retired and for those who are indigent. Sweden's entire population has equal access to public health care. The health care system is publicly funded. Longevity in Sweden is over 80. As a consequence of this welfare state, Sweden is one of the world's most egalitarian societies. It has the third lowest Gini coefficient, a measure of income inequality in a society, much lower compared to the United States. Education is mandatory for all children between the ages of 7 and 16. From the age of 1, children can be admitted to preschool. Preschools provide an environment that stimulates children's development and learning and enables parents to combine parenthood with work or studies. This pedagogy is continued in compulsory schools. The vast majority of schools in Sweden are municipally run. University education has been free of charge for Swedish, EU, EEA, and Swiss citizens. Interestingly, women are more educated than men. 26% of women versus 19% of men have post-secondary school education of 3 years or more. Roughly 10% of students enrolled in Swedish universities have international backgrounds, and this figure rises to 20% for those studying for research degrees. Swedish universities attract a high proportion of adult learners, and over 60% of students are women. Nearly 20,000 students are enrolled for a PhD degree in any given year. Sweden has at least 3 world-class universities. These attributes endow Sweden with a varied research culture that draws upon expertise from all over the world. Sweden has been a top performer on quality of life indicators. On the index of life satisfaction, Sweden was 4th in the world, while the US was 16th. The UN has rated Sweden as the most gender equal nation in the world. Crime rate is low in Sweden. The serious crime rate is but a fifth that of the United States and is declining. Sweden has been a humane nation. It gives 1% of its GDP in foreign aid, that is over $4 billion. This exceeds the UN's target of giving 0.7% of GDP in foreign aid. The money goes to 20 odd needy nations. Around 2.5 billion private sector foreign aid also flows out to needy countries. On a per capita basis, Swedish foreign aid may be about 4 times higher than that of the United States. Sweden has one of the best governance systems in the world. World Bank-based research and governance systems of over 150 countries indicates that on the criterion of government effectiveness, Sweden was rated one of the highest, as also on rule of law and control of corruption. Its ratings on these criteria have been far above those for India. Along with Britain and many other countries, Sweden has opted for large-scale agent certification of the government. This is a form of decentralization involving professional instead of bureaucratic management of government entities. This is added to the effectiveness of government functioning. For instance, the number of government decisions has been cut down by a factor of 4 since the 1960s by delegating decision-making authority to the agency level. On Transparency International's Corruption Perception Index, Sweden consistently ranks as one of the least corrupt. Sweden is a creative and innovative society. It scores high on climate for innovation. In the way Innovation Union scoreboard for 2011, Sweden was ranked as the leading EU nation out of 27 countries. In the INSEAD Global Innovation Index for 2011, Sweden ranked second. A contributing factor to Sweden's strong innovation position is that relative to GDP, industry invests a great deal in R&D. Literature and the arts are flourishing in Sweden. Swedish fiction is widely translated. Between 2006 and 2010, more than 3,300 titles were translated into some 50 other languages. Sweden is famous for design in wood, glass, and other media. The interplay of handicraft traditions and social democratic ideas has led to world-renowned work in industrial design, ergonomics, child safety, and products for the disabled. Artists are not completely dependent on commercial sales and wealthy patrons. Their creations are encouraged by public funding. The security provided by the welfare state frees them to make aesthetic risks without fear of destitution. One result is an artistic community known for avant-garde innovation. A parliamentary act stipulates that 1% of the expenditure on new public buildings must be devoted to works of art. Besides, Swedes have won some 30 Nobel Prizes despite the small size of Sweden's population. Americans have won 9 times more Nobel Prizes, but their population is over 30 times larger. There's much competition in Sweden, but Sweden has moved towards a sustainable competitive economy. The World Economic Forum's Global Competitiveness Report 2011-12 put Sweden into third place. This index measures the institutions, policies, and factors that set the stage for sustainable economic prosperity. Sweden may not yet have reached the peak of civilizational excellence, but it is worth pondering how Sweden has come this far. Through its welfare state, Sweden provides a platform for the widespread rise of what Abraham Maslow called higher order needs or self-actualization needs. These include the need to excel in one's calling and be creative, and the urge to be humane. As a social system that promotes autonomous human development, good citizenship, cooperation, and tolerance, the Swedes have developed a distinctive identity while remaining pluralistic. This identity is anchored in cooperation between traditionally antagonistic groups like workers and employers. Such cooperation facilitates the adoption of widespread innovations and changes. The result is the emergence of growing humaneness, creativity, and innovativeness, and the pursuit of excellence in one's chosen vocation. Some may dismiss Sweden's achievements by citing its small size compared to Goliaths like India or China or the US. But there are plenty of Sweden-sized states and districts in these Goliaths. How many can claim to be in Sweden's class as a civilization? Sweden is not an economic or political superpower, but it stands tall as a role model civilization. The world's nations differ widely, and each must forge its own distinctive path to civilizational excellence. But Sweden is inspirational. She demonstrates that advance towards civilizational excellence is possible, even in our savage times. Besides Sweden, in my book, I have also described how Japan and Germany, after the crushing devastation of the Second World War, dumped their authoritarian, brutal, and militaristic past and opted to become much more humane, creative, and excellence-seeking societies. These three examples strengthen my belief that despite an atmosphere of gloom and doom, it is possible for modern market economies that are democratic societies to take steps for advancing towards civilizational excellence. Can India become a more excellent civilization in its modern context? In the past, India has been one of the world's great civilizations. India has also achieved much since independence by building the world's third largest economy in PPP terms, drastically reducing poverty, doubling longevity, and quadrupling literacy. Indians have much to be proud of and also much to regret. Indians are proud of the non-violent way of gaining independence and the Gandhian legacy, and Indians being a remaining democratic secular people. We also have a robust civil society. Our political parties have ideologies that range from the extreme right to the extreme left. We have a vibrant media, a huge television and telecommunications coverage, and over 35,000 newspapers and periodicals that have increased access to information and entertainment exponentially. A number of NGOs are doing wondrous work for improving livelihoods, education, health, water availability, skilling, employment, and sustainable development. Amul is a shining example of the power of cooperation. We also have taken giant strides in space technology, IT and telecommunications, and we are poised for accelerated economic growth in the future. But we have much to regret also. Violence and crime are rampant in India. Around 200,000 murders, dacoities, robberies, and kidnappings occur every year. Over 25,000 rapes are recorded every year, although the actual number may be much higher. Another major threat blot is corruption. India is regularly rated as one of the most corrupt states by Transparency International. In 2014, it ranked 85th out of 183 nations. Justice system is poor in providing speedy justice, and we have a backlog of over 30 million cases in our justice system.
So, Professor Khandwalla, we'll have some opportunity for the interaction, because this is very interesting talk and some of the participants have some interesting questions to ask. Please just indicate when we can open this forum for the discussion.
I'll just finish and then we can open.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
The quality of schooling, especially government schools that cater to about 70% of the kids, is awful. According to studies, 25% of teachers are absent every day. Among rural children of age 10, half cannot read at a basic level. Over 60% are unable to do division, and half drop out by the age of 14. With so many problems, how can we make India an excellent civilization? Can India be a much more humane society? Can it be much more creative and innovative? Can a norm of pursuing high competence in one's tasks cast deep roots? Let me share some ideas on how we can become a better civilization. In my book, I have detailed many ideas. Here I will focus on some ideas relating to two major institutions vital for civilization excellence: education and government. We badly need to reform our rote education system so that students are well educated and pick up good values, learn to ask questions and develop their creativity and the spirit of excelling at whatever they wish to do. Let me give three examples of how this has been successfully attempted in India. These examples can give us clues about how to scale up creativity, competence, and humaneness in youngsters. In a remarkable experiment originating in Tamil Nadu, activity-based learning, or ABL, has revolutionized primary school learning in tens of thousands of government primary schools in a number of Indian states. ABL abjures rote learning and draws on the principles of the Montessori method of education. In this method, the responsibility for learning is that of the child, and the teacher is a facilitator. It unleashes the child's innate learning appetite and creativity and develops them further. The ABL pedagogy of self-learning can be extended with suitable modifications to the full spectrum of education in India, including higher education. The result could be more creativity and self-learning ability and a higher appetite for genuine competence. EduCom, an educational enterprise operating from Delhi, until its fall from grace a few years back, was able to deliver multimedia-enriched education digitally to over 12 million children in over 25,000 government as well as private schools' classrooms. This program is delivered by the internet with audiovisual aids and animation. The content was in English as well as in India's digital languages. Educom developed a digital library of thousands of multimedia modules for assisting teachers. Although the company has collapsed due to excessive borrowing, its pedagogy is proven. Such pedagogy offers much hope for bypassing decades of pathetic schooling, and alongside the computer and telecom revolutions, it can provide deeper learning and creatively enhancing education at relatively low cost to practically all the school children of India. How do we make our youths more human? How do we inculcate good citizen values in young people? Lok Bharati, a Gandhian institution of post-school learning in Gujarat, provides some inputs. The institution teaches subjects like economics, science, philosophy, and politics, but as anchors for practical living. Its mission has been to demonstrate how higher education can contribute in practical ways to tackling the problems of rural India. Community life at Lok Bharati lays emphasis on co-education, physical labor, and cooperation. It lays stress on values and character building, the dignity of labor, and the application of higher knowledge to solve the problems that beset poor people, especially the rural poor. For instance, knowledge acquired through studies is applied by the students to alleviate suffering during famines, floods, earthquakes, communal riots, and so forth. Lok Bharati is committed to holistic development. For instance, every student must study both the sciences and the humanities. The idea is to fuse technical expertise with wisdom and compassion. The second, the practical use of knowledge is strongly emphasized. As an example, students studying chemistry may go to a village, analyze the water from its wells to identify impurities, and counsel the locals on how to solve the problems created by these impurities. If we use the pedagogy of Lok Bharati widely in our colleges, especially work in rural areas, at least some physical labor, and the blending of the arts and the humanities courses in technology and science curricula, and vice versa, India can experience a surge of high quality, socially relevant, character building education. There is something more I would like to talk about in terms of government, because it is a very vital thing, but maybe there's the time to stop and let us have some interaction. Ashish?
Yes. So thanks very much, Professor, for enlightening us on this. Is important, is a very important question, that how we can attain the ideals of humanistic management in the market economy, because democracy and the market economy will be they seems to be inevitable in the current times. So very useful and thought-provoking observations are being shared. I'll request all the participants, those who wish to raise a question or share their observation, they are most welcome to intervene at this point of time.
Ashish, this is
yes.
Ben.
Yes, Ben.
So thank you very much, Professor, for your very insightful talk on civilization excellence. I was struck by your example on the importance of education for young people, especially on practical living lessons, character building, and using knowledge to alleviate suffering. My question is, do you think that management education itself should use a similar approach and enhance the character development of professional managers by engaging them in helping alleviate suffering or using their technical knowledge to help people? Because I don't see this as a very common practice in many business schools. Do you think that will be a useful direction to take for business education?
I certainly agree with that. In fact, I can cite several examples of MBA programs in India which require students to go out and work in rural areas, work with NGOs and so on. Right here in Ahmedabad, where I am located, there's a school, an MBA school called MICA, which requires students to go out and work in the rural areas surrounding Ahmedabad. There's a school in Delhi which requires that one day in a week, every student, this is a one-year program for people with experience, one day in a week they must spend with an NGO. They, of course, work in groups with the NGO. And I think these are very important things to do. There is similarly Irma in Anand, where again requires extensive work in rural areas by students. There is similarly SP Jain Institute in Mumbai, which also requires students to spend, as the director then put it, at least 1 month in a hut. So I think, yes, we need to humanize MBAs. We need to humanize professional managers so that they may certainly pursue profits, but they pursue profits in a humane fashion. And they care for the people.
Yeah, thank you for sharing those case examples. I would be very interested for any research that has established a link between the MBA programs that expose them to social service and their subsequent management decision styles as practitioners later on. So I would look forward to seeing any such research. Thank you, Professor.
If I come across that, I'll certainly pass it on.
Thank you.
So, Professor Khandwalla, one more thing I have been observing in the last few years, and you have observing the management education for so many years. Apart from IIM Ahmedabad, so IIM Ahmedabad, maybe because of the founder director or because of some reason, there has always been some conversation about the social responsibility and the social engagement. So maybe the center on the educational excellence or the agro-business probably were the expressions of those concerns. This is a response in a very structured way. But if we look at the current management education, the very structure is geared up towards, not very structure of the management education is not geared up toward nation building. It is more like cooperation and doing it well within the cooperation. How can we connect? And is there should we bother about connecting the management education with nation building?
Ashish, it's a very good question because it goes to the very heart of how IIMA and the IITs were formed. You see, Vikram Sarabhai and Pandit Nehru were good friends. And they thought of this idea that if you want to push India towards industrial growth, then we must have IITs and IIMs. They should be producing professional engineers, and IIMs should be producing professional managers. And they should then work together to push forward the industrial development agenda of India. That was the core idea.
Okay.
Somewhere along the line, at IIMA, certainly I can speak for IIMA because I was there for 30 years. At IIMA, somehow what happened was that, yes, we kept intact the social mission in the sense that we set up separate groups, one for agricultural management, one for public systems, one for educational innovation, and so on. So these things were set up. But the what we call the postgraduate program or the MBA program, that was really meant for the corporate sector. And effectively, because of the way we processed applications and the way we structured the courses and so on, essentially it became a place from which students went out to MNCs and consultancy companies, by and large, and professionally managed Indian companies. The whole idea that these students would go forward and professionalize management in the not so well managed companies was lost sight of. So that has been the tragedy of the IIMs. It's not just IIMA, all the IIMs put together and most of the business schools put together have had this problem. I certainly think that management is essential for India's development, any country's development. And it can't be just corporate management with its profit maximization goals. It has to blend in national concerns, social concerns. And therefore, it is important that we have an MBA program, a management program, in which national priorities, social priorities are highlighted. And examples are given of how companies can provide inputs into these priorities. If this can be done, and in my book I've cited many, many examples of companies that are doing that, then it's entirely possible to have an educational system, MBA programs, that are not only concerned about producing excellent professional managers, but excellent concerned managers, socially concerned and nationally concerned managers.
So can I ask a question, Ashish?
Yes, yes, Payal, please go ahead.
Hello. This is Payal from Delhi. Just to add that we're a pretty new university, BML Mondal University. We're 5 years old. But in our vision and mission, we actually have that, you know, we want to create ethical leaders of our undergraduates and MBA students. So as part of our MBA course, we have a project called Sankalp, which we've actually created as a 3-credit course, where the children have to go into the rural villages. They have to go into the rural community near us and come up with a project to increase the income of the community, which has to be sustainable when the students leave. So this is a very interesting initiative. My question is that, you know, apart from getting the students to do projects like that, working with rural communities and thinking about their needs, and apart from a lot of, we ask them to write a lot of reflective essays, I mean, what else can we do as educators to bring about concerned managers?
You know, one of the most powerful ways of influencing young minds is bring to the classroom people who have made outstanding contributions. I've seen this in something called the Aspire Circle, where I used to curate a group of social leaders for 3 or 4 years. And there, we brought in people who had really made major contributions. They were professional managers. Some of them left their professional management corporate jobs and became NGO heads and so forth. But when you see somebody making such a major contribution where 500,000 people are impacted, their children's excitement about education is increased manyfold, where water is reached to people who are starved of water, you know, where you have somebody who leaves a job, a government job, comes to Kutch when there is an earthquake, stays on from, she comes from Goa. She was enrolled for a PhD in France. She didn't take it up, instead rushed to Kutch to help out people because of a huge earthquake in 2001, and so on. And when you have people like that, the young minds do get influenced quite a bit. So yes, I think the work your school is doing in terms of getting students out to the countryside to double their incomes is a very worthwhile project, and I certainly commend it greatly. But I think it's equally important to bring role models to the classroom. Bring in people who have made an impact. They have succeeded in business, and yet they also have made an impact socially. And from Miami, I can talk of several people who have done this. Kiran Karnik and other people are there who have done that, but there are very few. But nonetheless, they are important. We should get hold of them and get them to the classroom. Ashish may remember the Javaja project, which Ravi Mathai had undertaken, Uday, Ravi Mathai and others. And it did greatly influence the youngsters from IMA who used to go to Javaja to look at the rural area and how the whole thing was done. So this can be done. This is not, and this is completely compatible with the Gandhian tradition in India. Gandhi's education system was what? Practical. You must have practical application of what you know. So practical application in the social good. So this has been a tradition in India from many old times. And And certainly Gandhiji reinforced this, and I think it can be done. You don't have to sacrifice the quality of professional education, but you can certainly energize it, inspire it, and make it more creative, more innovative through this kind of social interaction, through role models, and so forth.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I'm a research scholar from Mumbai, and thank you so much for the wonderful insight about humanistic management efforts already in India, like spearheaded by a lot of conglomerates, and your book about it. And your wonderful examples, like, you know, Sweden as a civilization. So my question is basically, my research is about dignity in the employment relationships.
Yes.
I am more keen to understand that although the conglomerates are driving it, but then, you know, those are huge organizations who are looking outside of the companies and trying to do better, you know, social good. But, you know, I want to know more about the nuances inside the company. It's like, you know, there are people like Donna Hicks from Howard University who are dignity consultants, but the developed nations are very open to this idea. And they let them, you know, they hire dignity consultants to understand their nuances and help them in, you know, topics like conflict management and day-to-day dealings. How do we do this in India? How do we generate this in, interest in the organizational leaders in even smaller companies or medium-sized companies in India?
Very good question, to which I have no answer because I really have not looked at the issue very carefully. Many things that are happening in the West, you can certainly look at them and try to see if we can replicate them here or modify them as per our needs. You know, the thought that strikes me is that in the West, this dignity of people, dignity of particularly of women at work, arose because there was more dignity at home. Basically, you had, from a patriarchal system, the West moved towards a more egalitarian home environment. And I think when that happens, almost certainly it will have a spillover effect in the workplace. So we need to work at both avenues. We certainly need to have legislation and rules and regulations and make people aware of how to keep people's dignity at work. But at the same time, we also need to work at the level of the families in India, where still the woman is a second class family member. She's treated as she's a mother, she's a sister, she's a daughter, and so on. And we worship the mother goddess, etc. But nonetheless, the boss is still the father, the male, and the woman is kind of subsidiary. So we need to change that. I think that is also important. Now, a lot of NGOs are working on this. Seva in Ahmedabad, for example, has 2 million women who were rag pickers and so on, who have been brought together in Seva, and they've got now work they can do. They're earning, and earning is one way by which you restore the dignity of the woman. And I think if that happens, then it will certainly have a spillover in the larger companies. I would imagine that, exceptions apart, by and large, people are treated fairly okay. I mean, there would be the odd insulting behavior. But by and large, people are aware that there are laws and there are penalties for abusing the rights of people. But what the problem is with the smaller enterprises, there are 56 million small businesses in India, employing about 30-40% of the workforce. So that is where women is still not treated well. And that is not treated well because the basic social strata from which these businesses come, their woman is not respected enough. We have to tackle that problem also.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks very much to all the participants and to Professor Khandwalla. The session timing was 3:30 to 4:30. We have exceeded a little bit because we started a little later. Again, the apologies for the same. The next session most likely will be offered by Professor Madhukar Shukla. He is a very experienced academician in the field of social entrepreneurship. I'll share his introduction a little later, but he is the one professor who started writing about and talking about social entrepreneurship in 1980s. And very unusual, because now last few years we have started knowing and talking more about the social entrepreneurship, but he was the one who talked about those things in the 80s. So we will have Professor Madhukar Shukla as the next speaker. And if there is any change in the program, I will let you know. If there's a time constraint, then some other speaker will come first and then the Professor Shukla, but he's certainly going to be next one or the next to next one. So thanks very much for all of you. If you have any observation, comments or question, you may please feel free to leave it on the chat box. Hopefully some of us who are called to respond to those questions will respond to those. And so thanks very much, Ben, for supporting this initiative, Michael for starting this and connecting many of us on this forum of humanistic management. So thanks very much to all of you.